This is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. I have another exciting episode for you, and today I'm in my front yard garden and we're going to answer your guys' questions. So once again, if you do have a question for me, it's best to post it on my YouTube channel page on the comments section, or actually email me to me over the YouTube email system. If you do post a question down below the video, I often read them, but am unable to answer to each and every one because literally I get hundreds of questions each and every day throughout all 815 now of my videos that I've posted. So, you know, I do take select questions and answer them in a Q&A session like this, and I'm glad to be able to do this. Now, before I go on, what I want to say is that, you know, these plants behind me, while you may think, John, you know, you're in your front yard garden, I thought you only grow edibles. Well, I grow all edibles except one hydrangea plant that I just didn't have the heart to pull out when I moved in my place. But this is actually an edible. While it does look quite ornamental and really cool and actually grows really well here in Northern California, it produces an edible tuberous root. It's called the Canna edalis, or just simply Canna. So the root can be eaten raw and or cooked. So this is second growth year. I've kind of just planted it and let it doing its thing. And this year, it's coming back with the vengeance. It didn't make it during the winter. It died back. I cut it down in the soil, and now it's just sprouting up everywhere, man. So after this year, I'm going to finally harvest some and see what the heck the stuff tastes like. So definitely looking forward to that, and I'll make a video once I do. Anyways, I'm replanting new stuff right now, but I figured I'd take a break and answer your questions. So let's get right into them. First question is from, this is a tough word, EU-Dioma Portal. Hey, John, love your work, man. I recently purchased some green smart self-watering pots, which are very similar to your Growums containers. I am just wondering if you add real live worms to those containers. Peace. All right, so I do not add worms to my Growums containers, although you can. That being said, I don't recommend you add worms to your Growums containers. You know, number one, I like worms in like the ground in my raised beds, which they have a large amount of space to go into, and they could kind of burrow into the ground and just go over they need to in a container. It's like, you know, if you're a pet being kept in a cage all day, all night. And the other thing that really concerned me about the Growum containers, because it is a self-watering container, it's always going to have a consistent moisture level for the most part throughout most parts of it. And the worms like it, you know, of certain moisture level, which it might not correspond with the moisture level in the Growums pot because it is self-watering. I kind of think that the Growums container might be a little bit too much water, too much moisture for the worms. You know, in regular soil, there's dry parts, there's wet parts, and the worms will kind of go wherever they want to. And in a container, self-watering container, they're not going to have that option. So I would say, you know, use worm castings in your Growums container. Put a good potting soil mixture in your container if you're wondering what to put in a Growums container or self-watering container. Check my past videos. I did a really good episode on filling my Growums container with what, you know, soil mixture I use, and I include the worm compost or the worm castings in there, so I got the nutrition from the worms without the worms actually being in there. I guess we'll get to the next question. It's from Joe 232409. Question: lots of soil in my beds is being taken over by common brown cup mushrooms. They grow in clumps, sometimes up to 6 to 8 inches. In a few places, they were pushing my small plants over. These are actually edible, but they taste bitter, and I don't like the flavor or mushrooms at all. I let some go through their lifespan in the winter, which is about 3 months. I'm concerned that the mushrooms could be sapping away nutrients from my other plants, especially since my plants are still pretty small and these things are growing huge. I pull out the big chunks to add to my compost and leave the smaller ones, since nature really wants to grow these mushrooms, and who am I to disagree? But I'm curious, what do you recommend? Should I let them grow? Should I pull them all? Or should I keep taking out the larger ones? I'm half excited about this happening with my soil, but half concerned that perhaps a nutrient is missing since these grow like a weed. Thanks, John. All right, so here's my take on the mushrooms growing in the garden. Yes, I have had this issue actually in the past winter myself, actually. So the thing is, and the thing I want you guys to realize about your garden is that nature happens. It's like compost happens. Nature happens, you know. Nature's gonna do whatever it wants. And, you know, nature, believe it or not, is one of the most complicated systems out there. I mean, we have computer systems, and we have this kind of systems, but it's nothing compared to nature. And the fungus or mushrooms in your growing bed is happening for a reason, because the area is encouraging mushrooms because of what's going on. So two of the things that's easily identifiable, in my opinion, that why mushrooms are growing. Number one, very wet conditions. If it's too dry, mushrooms are just simply not going to grow. They're going to grow somewhere else. Number two, food for the mushrooms, in which case, you know, I've seen that a high, you know, wood chip soil with a lot of organic matter tends to grow mushrooms better than a sandy soil, for example. So you have probably both those things going on. Now, mushrooms, fungus, and bacteria, they're great, basically, consumers. And what they consume is, you know, the wood chips, which are not easily absorbed by your plants, for example. And then the mushrooms kind of digest and absorb them, break them down, and make them into a form that's available to your plants. So believe it or not, the mushrooms are doing a favor for you. They're actually making fertilizer to make your raised beds richer. And this is a good thing. The bad thing is if they're, you know, taking over and pushing your plants down, that's not a good thing. So, you know, it's kind of tough. I mean, what you're doing now is great. What I would do personally is I don't like how mushrooms look. I personally don't like to eat mushrooms. And the other thing is I want to tell all my viewers, before any mushrooms, you know, grow in your garden, before you eat them, you want to make sure you know what they are before you even put any mushroom in your mouth. Some of them could be deadly. Some could be toxic. I mean, really not a good thing just to be plucking mushrooms, especially if you're not a mycologist and don't know what the hell you're doing. So in that case, what I generally do is all mushrooms that grow in my garden, if there's like, you know, besides small little clumps, which are cool, I, number one, figure out why they're occurring. Like if it's the winter and it's raining a lot, then they're occurring because it's raining a lot. And then as soon as it stops raining as much, they'll go away. So I'll try to fix it that way. You know, if you're watering, maybe you're watering too much. Maybe you need to dial down the water a little bit so it's not as wet, then that'll discourage the mushrooms coming. What I would do is actually I'd probably pull all the mushrooms above the ground, because even though you're pulling all the mushrooms above the ground, there's still tons of spores below the ground. And that's just me for my, you know, growing style. If I had acreage, I'd probably just let them all grow. As long as they didn't compete with my plants too much, I'd be cool with it. But in a situation where I'm growing in a small tight space, I want to keep things neat, clean, and orderly. I'm going to just pull them all. And yes, put them right into your compost pile, let them compost down and break back and feed your compost pile. All right, next question is from Ramon Jet 1973. How soon can one garden soil that was recently contaminated by the backwash from the swimming pool, not a saltwater pool? I like to use both raised beds and plant directly in the soil. All right, so the first thing I would say is, number one, make your pool a saltwater pool so that this doesn't happen again. That being said, I have no experience with growing in a soil that's been contaminated with the backwash from the swimming pool. You know, to me, that doesn't seem as bad as some other contaminations like lead contamination or something else. That being said, you know, in a standard swimming pool, I know they put chlorine and other chemicals in there that'll probably jack up your soil. Probably you lost all the microbiology in there with the backwash. So I would encourage you bringing in organic matter in the form of, you know, good compost. Of course, add the rock dust. You want to also be sure to use compost teas in the area and bring back some life in the soil. So also use the wood chip hummus. I've had it on my show before called California hummus, and I have a show soon, or have already had a show on the boogie hummus. You want to add some of that in there to get some of that stuff in there, because that'll help break down and kind of detoxify, you know, the soil. That being said, you know, I just start planting it and see what the heck happens, you know. I don't think it's like so contaminated that you shouldn't eat out of it. You know, it's not like Fukushima happened right there and it's all radioactive or anything. It's just some pool water that had some chlorine, and, you know, and hopefully you're, even the chlorine in your pool is not super high amounts. I mean, it is all dilute and it's in water and it all washed through. So I'd start growing, you know, sooner rather than later. And I'd probably rather use that area for shrubs and trees rather than, you know, tender, you know, leafy green vegetables. I'd probably first use it for peppers and tomatoes rather than direct leafy greens or herbs that I'd be harvesting and picking directly. All right, next question is from Blue Worm 123. Hey, you always state to use rock dust or gypsum in your garden for trace minerals. Would the same effect come from grinding up some drywall sheets and tossing it into the soil, since it's primarily compost of gypsum? All right, Blue Worm. So number one, I have to get this straight. When I say rock dust, I don't just mean any old rocks. I mean, just gypsum is rocks, granite is rocks, limestone is rocks. There's so many different kinds of rocks, igneous rocks, basalt rocks. You know, there's 30 different kinds of rocks, and when I say rock dust, I don't just mean any old kind of rock just ground up into dust and then put on your garden. Actually, adding too much gypsum could be a bad thing, in my opinion. So, what I recommend when I say rock dust, what I specifically mean is a wide spectrum rock. So, a rock that you grind up that has a wide cross-section of minerals. So, some of the rock dust I use have like 70-plus different minerals. You know, ground up wallboard or gypsum may only have a handful. Green sand has a bunch more. But we want to get the widest amount of minerals. Like in trace minerals, in my opinion, the more a variety, the better in your garden. You don't want just single minerals going in your garden. That can definitely imbalance things, and that's actually a problem. Why you've heard things like don't add too much lime, or don't add too much calcium, or don't add too much gypsum, could, you know, get your soil balance off. But the trace minerals are in such small, minute amounts, but a wide variety, that it's not going to have, not going to pose, for the most part, the challenges. This is especially true of using horticultural grade rock dust, like I recommend. The Azomite and the Guy Green Glacial Rock Dust are two of the ones I've used. I've also used some other local companies' rock dust in the past. So gypsum is not the same thing. If you do want to add gypsum, you know, you could probably grind up wallboard for the gypsum. But, you know, gypsum is relatively inexpensive, and grinding up wallboard is probably a pain in the ass, and they may be adding things to the gypsum in the wallboard also these days, which probably is not good for your garden as well. So the right tool for the right job is what my grandfather used to tell me, and you know, I'd recommend the right rock dust for your garden for the job. All right, next question is from Steven Henstridge. Hi, I've been watching your videos on YouTube, and it seems to me that you use azomite in your garden. I live in a small province called Newfoundland, which is located on the east coast of Canada. With that said, I just started my own garden this year using raised gardens. Now I'm trying to find azomite everywhere. Is there anything else I could use besides azomite? All right, Steven, so besides azomite, what we're looking for is a broad spectrum of trace minerals to add into your soil. This, in my opinion, is probably one of the most critical elements or nutrients that's missing from most gardens today, just because of the topsoil erosion and all this stuff. And I want you guys to add a wide spectrum of trace minerals to your garden. So besides the azomite, which is a brand of rock dust actually mined in Utah in the United States, there's another brand that's actually called Gaia Green Glacial Rock Dust, and they're from Canada, eh? You newfie, you. And so yeah, there's a variety of rock dust actually mined in Canada. I think it's from British Columbia, and they do have distribution throughout Canada. So I think it's like gaiagreen.ca is the website of the company. So you want to contact them and find out a local distributor in your area. Now that's a horticultural grade rock dust. Now, even so, you still might not be able to find the horticultural grade rock dust. And that's the one that I recommend. Those are the two brands that I currently use in my garden. But if you can't find that, it's all right. The best thing, you always want to do the best you can. Instead of getting the horticultural grade, if you can't do it, the next best thing is to go to a local rock and stone quarry that are mining the rocks at the ground. And you want to go there and you want to get their finest particle size that'll pass through like a 200 mesh screen or whatever. And it literally looks like dust. It looks like baking flour. It's like that fine. And you want to ask them for their rock fines, their rock dust, or whatever, you know, because when they process it and grind it down into different sizes and different aggregates, you know, they'll have this leftover waste product, basically. And for them, it's a waste product because they don't know what the heck to do with it. They don't sell that stuff. And so that's the stuff you want. You could go drive your truck down to a rock quarry and get it by the truckload, you know, for literally cheap. And now the thing is, that's going to be a fairly wide spectrum, and hopefully it's a mixed rock dust of different nutrients in there. It's not going to be the horticulture grade, it's not going to be a proven, you know, grade or nothing, but adding some rock dust like that, in my opinion, is far better than not adding it. That being said, you also want to do what's called a pot test. Now, that's not like smoking pot and then growing your plants. That's actually taking some of the rock dust, maybe before you buy it, and taking a bunch of it and taking it home and mixing it with your compost and growing a pot like a tomato plant or pepper or maybe some arugula in the pot with the rock dust and with your compost, and then use just your compost and grow it in there and see what happens. If the one with the rock dust and the compost grows faster, then you know it's good stuff. And if it doesn't grow as fast, then you might be concerned and maybe not want to get that stuff before you buy it. So, you know, that's always prudent to do a pot test. No, don't get high before you grow your plants. might be hard for some of you guys. But anyways, that's a pot test. So hopefully that helps you out there, Steven. All right, next question is from Stropisports or something like that. All right. Question, John. I have a huge ant problem. They are taking over my whiskey barrels. How do you stop them? Well, you know, I saw this Disney movie called Ants, and literally in that movie, you just cannot stop them. All right, just kidding. So how you want to stop ants is you want to remove their food source. You know, just like nature, ants come when there's something to eat. Like, you know, people flock to McDonald's all the time because there's food to eat there. Well, except you're me, then I'm flocking to my garden to eat. But, you know, you want to remove the food source. So imagine if all the McDonald's and fast food joints closed down. What would people do? Maybe they'd flock to the grocery stores, then close all the grocery stores down. Then what'd they do? Maybe they'd start growing their own food then. That might be a good thing. But anyways, you want to remove the food source. So the ants, you know, when I usually see ants, I got some ants on my collard greens right now. And that's because the collard greens actually have aphids. And the aphids are sucking the juice, sucking the lifeblood out of the collard plants. That doesn't sound too nice. And then what happens is they poop this sticky, sugary substance called honeydew. And then the ants actually go up and get that honeydew because that's food for the ants. So, I mean, once again, this is nature's system. So if you do have plants and they're in your wine barrels, you know, they may have some insect issues and it's causing a food for the ants. The other thing, I've seen ants just go into the whiskey barrels or pots because that's like they make a home out of it. They carve it out or whatever they do underneath there. So you want to try to remove them. So there's a few products I recommend. I do have an episode actually where I talk more about this on the ants. I use this product called Orange Guard. It's basically made from the extract of orange peels, D-limonene, I believe is what it is, and that'll take care of the ant issue. Another thing that you might want to do is make bait. So making ant bait is relatively easy. You want to take some like powdered sugar and boric acid and just mix those together. I don't know, just like a 1-to-1 ratio or something like that, and then just to mix it together and just spread it everywhere. And then the ants will like go nuts because you're feeding them sugar. And then, but also they're taking the boric acid. The boric acid is like a time release, like poison for them. And it's non-toxic. And actually it might be good for your soil too, because most soils might not have enough borate. Now we're down to the last question. It's from Miles Adams. Hi, John. Just wondering, I've read on Remineralize website that you can feed worms rock dust. Have you done this yourself? Either way, can it be done without negative effects? So let's see, Miles. I don't believe I've actually ever fed my worms a rock dust, other than actually putting a lot of rock dust in my raised beds, right? And, you know, filling them up, and then the worms come, and they're eating the rock dust and the other stuff in my raised beds. But I don't have a worm farm where I actually added the rock dust to it for the worms. That being said, I do add the rock dust to my compost piles all the time, and encourage you guys to add the rock dust to your compost piles and also your worm bins. You know, it's definitely going to act as roughage for the worm. It's also going to improve the castings that the worms are generating. You know, in my opinion, it's not going to hurt unless you add too much. You know, too much, you know, the rock dust is a fine powder. It can actually remove moisture from your worm bin, your worm box, which is a negative thing. So, you know, just every time you put some food in there, maybe sprinkle a little more rock dust, you know, just a little bit, not too much, so that you got some, but you're not overloading it with rock dust. And in my opinion, that's definitely going to be a good thing. Well, that's pretty much the end of the questions and answers for today. Hope you guys were enriched by some of my answers. Stay tuned for upcoming episodes where I'm back in the garden showing you some cool stuff. And actually, maybe today I'm going to be actually planting some things out, and then I'm going to be dividing some of your cone, one of my favorite things to do in the garden. So hopefully you guys enjoyed this episode. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and remember, keep on growing.